Good morning.
Good morning.
Our first scripture reading this morning comes from Psalm 24, verses 3 through 6, which you can find in the Old Testament on page 504 in your pew Bibles. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord, and who shall stand in his holy place? Those who have clean hands and pure hearts, who do not lift up their souls to what is false, and do not swear deceitfully. They will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from the God of their salvation. Such is the company of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Our second reading this morning comes from the New Testament, book of Acts, chapter 11, verses 19 through 26, which is on page 130 in the pew Bibles. Now those who were scattered because of the persecution that took place over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, and they spoke the word to no one except Jews. But among them were some men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who on coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists, also proclaiming to the Lord Jesus. The hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number became believers and turned to the Lord. News of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent Barnabas to Antioch. When he came and saw the grace of God, he rejoiced, and he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast devotion, for he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and of faith. And a great many people were brought to the Lord. Then Barnabas went to Tarsus to look for Saul, and when he had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for an entire year they met with the church and taught a great many people, and it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians.
It's always a delight to be with you. This is one of my favorite churches. I think you're so accepting. They're so warm in your welcome that we're always very, very glad when you call us to preach here. I haven't heard from you for a little while, so I thought you'd forgotten about me. Then I looked over my past service to see what terrible things I must have said before you forgot all about me. But you do make it a delight for Betty and I to drive down from Dingley's Ferry to be with you. And I appreciate the fact that I can come down, because if I see someone sleeping, I can point right to them. I like to preach close to you. The Christmas season is just about all over. Maybe it is all over. Remember way back when we began the church year, we began the Christian year with the beginning of the four Sundays of Advent, preparing for Christmas. Then it was Christmas Eve, when most of our churches are filled with people who delight to come out and hear the angels singing again that a baby is to be born, and Christmas Day. And then, of course, just last week, we had Epiphany, where the wise men come and go home another way. And I thought to myself, what should be my sermon? I, as a Baptist, do not follow the liturgical year too carefully. Now, what would I want to preach on that I think is essential for someone to hear now that the Christmas season is over? And I thought, why not preach on Christianity? I ought to be able to get 20 minutes out of Christianity. After all, we have now had Christ come into the world. And they are first called Christians in Antioch. Up there is Barnabas and Paul, and they're ministering to a new church with a new idea, because Gentiles are now joining the Jewish Christians for the first time anywhere. And for the first time, they're called Christians. So I thought to myself, what is a Christian? What is Christianity? terms that they use to describe Christianity that I never understood. You know, sanctification and justification and atonement, and some of those words were so complicated I didn't understand them. And I wanted to put together a sermon that would define Christianity apart from those great theological phrases. And so I put together this sermon and ask you to stay with me to see if it helps you understand Christianity. Eight words. The first word, the first two words, come down. Come down. After all, Philippians, the second chapter, in one of the first great hymns of the church, talks about God emptying himself and sending his Son into the world. God emptied heaven of his own Son and sent him into the world. He came down. God so loved the world, he gave his Son. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. We think so much of the sacrifice and of the pain of the Godhead on the cross. We forget the great pain that God must have felt when he gave up his own Son. Philippians says, the prized possession of heaven, God took his Son and gave him away. Emptied heaven of his prized possession. He came down. Did you ever think of how much pain that must have caused God to be all alone without his companion? The only thing I could think of to compare it was when our first child went to kindergarten school for the first day. We dressed her all up appropriately. We filled her little lunch pail and her school box with pencils and erasers and crayons and little lunch. And we took her to the door. She was so excited. And we walked down the driveway to the mailbox where she would be picked up by the bus. And she was bubbling over with enthusiasm and excitement. She couldn't wait to get to school for her first day. And soon up around the corner, we saw the bus take a right-hand turn. That big yellow bus come down our street and stop at our mailbox and pick up our little girl. And she jumped aboard, and all of her friends greeted her. She was immediately surrounded with joy and laughter and excitement, and that yellow bus just kept on going. And we turned around and walked back up the driveway to an empty house, to a quiet, silent house that was now empty. No little child there. No laughter, no running, no pounding, no noise. And there was pain. There was pain of being all alone in our house without our little girl, who now began her first day of school and would be separated with us in a certain way for years and years to come. How empty our home felt without her. And that can't even begin to compare without how empty Jesus was, God, heaven was without Jesus. I don't understand at all the pre-existence of the Godhead, but I know God emptied born in a manger is a baby whose name is Jesus. The first way to identify Christianity is the two words, come down. And the next two words are come in. Come in. If you want to define Christianity, you have to say, come in. We used to sing that old song up here at Echo Lake, not too far up the road. When I was a pastor in Allentown for 12 years, we had a Baptist conference center and a Baptist camp. And for 12 years, I led a junior high summer camp for 2 weeks. Young people from Philadelphia and Lancaster and New York all the way up to Scranton and Wilkes-Barre came to this camp. We always had 200 or 250 junior high young people for 2 weeks. And every night, weather permitting, we would have a big campfire. And we would sit around and sing some of the old camp songs we all loved and some of the spirituals and choruses. One of the things that young people used to like to sing best of all is, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Into my heart. Into my heart. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Come in today. Come in to stay. Come into my heart, Lord Jesus. You see, it doesn't matter how it's done, but it needs to be done. If we are defined in Christianity, we have to say, come in. It does no good for God to carry out all of his acts unless we open our hearts and say, come in. Come into my heart. Come into my life. It doesn't matter how we do it. Some people do it in Madison Square Garden with a huge Billy Graham campaign. Hundreds and thousands come forward and say, come into my heart, Lord Jesus. Or it may be in your home, just by your bedside. You have a loving mother or father or maybe a loving grandparent who talks to you and tells you stories about Jesus and God and invites you to have him come. Or it may be just the result of a confirmation class when you're a careful pastor who tries to train you in some biblical understanding, at the end asks you if you want to become a church member or a Christian. It doesn't matter how we do it, but somewhere along the way we have to say, come in. Come into my heart. Come into to Abraham and gave him a promise. He came to Jacob and gave him a dream. He came to Moses and gave him the law. He came to David and gave him a kingdom. He came to the prophets and gave them a judgment. He came mainly through Jesus. And he wants to come into your heart just like he did to Abraham and Jacob. And Moses and David, he wants to come into your heart. And that's the second part of being a Christian. Come down. Come in. And then there is the third part of being a Christian. Come out. Come out. Come out. You see, you can't contain Jesus within your life. A light cannot be hidden under a bushel. If you invite Jesus into your life and into your heart, you will find that he wants to come out. He wants to be a light that shines in darkness. There are two sides to the same coin. One side of the coin says, come in. The other side of the coin says, come out. James says in his little epistle, faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. There has to flow from your life the activities that Jesus performed when he ministered to the poor and the limited and the handicapped and the widow and the orphan and the needy. We have to minister to them also. We have to do the things that Jesus did. We have to reflect his actions in our activities. Faith, having Jesus on the inside, is dead, useless, unimportant, unless you somehow let it out and try to make the church and the world and your home and your marriage and your family a better place, because Jesus is bursting the seams and coming out of your life. I remember, do you remember the, we used to sing, as was mentioned in the children's sermon, we used to sing in the 60s and 70s, "They will know we are Christians by our love." How? By our love. They will know we are Christians not by our creeds, not by the documents we claim to confess, not by the faith that we once had. They will know we are Christians by our love. Our love for the people of the world who are waiting for the representatives of Jesus Christ to come out and minister to their need. And so we have six of the eight words defining Christianity. Come now. Come in. Come out. By the way, do you remember John the Baptist, who was in prison? Herod had thrown him in prison, and he was about to lose his head. And John the Baptist, that great preacher from the Jordan River, for just a moment, seems to have some questions about his faith. Seems to have a few doubts. He knows Herod's going to kill him. And he says to his disciples, "Go and find Jesus in Galilee and ask him, are you the one that we expected? Or do we have to look for another?" Just for a moment, he wondered. He had expected the Messiah to do different things. And so he wanted to know, are you the anointed one? Are you the Messiah? Are you the Savior, the one that we need? Or do we need to look for another one? And what does Jesus say to those representatives of John the Baptist who just before he dies want some assurance? Jesus says, wait a minute, look around you. The blind see, the deaf hear, the lame are walking, the lepers are cleansed. Even the dead are being raised from the dead. Go and tell John what you see. And he will know that I am the one. That's how people know that we are the one. Not that we walk through the door and we sit here for an hour through a dull sermon. They will know we are Christians by our love, by what comes out of us, by our actions. The things that Jesus did are the things that we need to do. And the seventh and eighth words, come up. Come up. If I'm going to define Christianity, this is how I'm going to going to do it, not by justification and sanctification and atonement. I'm going to do it by saying, come down, come in, come out, come up. I guess in my ministry I've had probably close to 350 or 400 funeral memorial services. And almost every one, or at least half of them, I always, always love to quote the 14th chapter of John. The 14th chapter of John is so comforting. In my Father's house there are many rooms. In my Father's house there are many rooms. And if it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, in heaven, you may be also. You may be also. There's something wonderful for a Christian walking away from the grave site of a loved one and knowing in their heart that they are not there in the ground, but they have already joined Jesus Christ in heaven. They are already a part of God's family in heaven. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing in life can get his. Nothing about death can separate us from the love of God. Come up! Come up! Because he has prepared a place. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, one of my favorite people, one of my saints, as you know, great German pastor, who during the Nazi reign left the Lutheran Church and formed his own, what he called, confessing church, confessing seminary, that was willing to stand firm for Jesus Christ against the policies of the practices of the native Nazi government. Because of that, he was arrested. He did not go along with all the other pastors. Christ had come into his life, and Christ was now coming out of his life by his being faithful. And 3 days in April 1945, 3 days before his camp was freed, hated him so much for his faithfulness to God that they hanged him. 3 days before he would have been freed. But the jailer who wrote a book about Bonhoeffer's experience said he never saw a man die like this man. As he was going to have the noose put around his neck, he looked out upon his friends who were there and said, "This for you seems to be the end, but for me it is just the beginning. For me it is just the beginning." That's real Christian. If you were to ask me to define Christianity today, I wouldn't use any of all those terms, those theological expressions that I discovered in seminary or in graduate school. If you were to ask me to define Christianity, I would use 8 words. Come down. Come in. Come out. I hope they're helpful to you. Let's pray. thank you, Lord God, for